Hello viewers, welcome to the lecture of graph representation. Myself, Dr. Preeti Jagwani, I am from Department of Computer Science, Aryabhatta College, University of Delhi. In today's lecture, we are going to concentrate wholly upon how to represent graphs. In the previous lectures, we have seen what actually a graph is. So, just to give you a quick recap of the graph as a data structure, it is basically a set of vertices and edges. So, every node in the graph is known as vertex, and there is an connection between those edges, between those vertex, and that is known as an edge. So, here on the screen you can see just a random graph of cities. These cities are connected to each other by some communication ways, maybe a roadways, railways, or whatever the communication way is. So, here we can say we are having a graph of cities, or maybe let us consider another scenario which says social networks. So, just being curious about how does this graph of a social network look like. So, something which is shown upon on screen. So, basically a very dense graph with lots of edges and lots of vertices. So, we can say it is a kind of a very dense graph with so many vertices and so many edges onto that vertices. So, graphs are actually serving lots of purposes in the domain of computer science. So, coming to how to represent the graph inside the memory of the computer. See, if we want to use graph to solve a particular problem, or we need a data structure which is a graph and we need to apply an algorithm onto it. So, the first requirement for this is we need to represent that particular graph, and that representation is has to be inside the memory of the computer. So, that is what you called graph representation. Basically, graph representation, as we can say, is a technique to store graph inside the memory of the computer. So, now what are the ways to represent the graph inside the computer memory? There can be many ways, but yes, we need to find out some optimal ways to represent a graph apart in the list of those available ways. And this representation actually depends upon how many number of vertices are there, what is the density of edges, what are the types of operations you want to perform on that particular data structure, what are the algorithms you want to run on that particular graph structure. So, all these things, all these factors basically contribute in order to decide a representation. So, coming to the representations of graph, there can be a number of representations, like adjacency array, adjacency matrix, and adjacency list, but the most commonly used representations are adjacency matrix and adjacency list. So, in today's lecture, we are basically focusing upon the adjacency matrix, how it look like, how are we going to form the adjacency matrix for different kinds of graphs, whether it is a directed graph, indirected graph, edges, weighted graph, or what kind of graph it is, and what will be the corresponding adjacency matrix. And then we will definitely see that what are the common operations which are beneficial if we have chosen the adjacency matrix representation. So, coming up to the adjacency matrix representation of graph, before going into adjacency matrix representation, let us define what do we actually mean by the term adjacency. As the name indicates, something or a pair which is kind of adjacent to each other. So, in terms of graph terminology, we can say if for two vertices A and B, there is an edge E joining them, a single edge E joining them, we say that these A and B are adjacent. Now, my dear students, please understand that there is a difference between the term adjacent and incident. If I am talking about adjacent, then I am specifically talking about two vertices being adjacent, and if I am talking about the term incident, that means I am talking about edges. So, if two edges, let us say E and F, have a common vertex, these edges are known as incident edges, and if there are two vertices and there is an edge E joining them, so we can say A and B are adjacent vertices. So, in terms of adjacency matrix, what adjacency we are looking for is specifically adjacency between two vertices. So, adjacency matrix is, in order to define an adjacency matrix, we can simply say that it is a sequential representation. Now, what kind of sequential representation? It represents which nodes are adjacent to each other, or more specifically we can say, looking at an adjacency matrix, one can easily find out that is there any edge connecting the nodes, connecting any two nodes of a graph. So, basically in adjacency matrix, what do we do? This matrix is going to be a matrix of size V cross V, where V is the size of the vertex set, or simply we can say V is the number of vertices in the graph. So, we are going to make a matrix of V cross V, or simply we can say it is a 2D array of size V cross V, and the data of a particular I cross J, if it is a 2D array, so I can say, let us say I am naming the array as the name adjacent ADJ, so edge. So, edge ij is going to be 1, it indicates that there is an edge from vertex I to vertex j. Then we are going to write 1 in place of that vertex. So, for example, considering 5 vertices in an array, so if there is an edge from vertice number 1 to vertice number 2, so the array index, that 2D array index of 1, 2 is going to have 1 into its location. So, something of this sort, which is shown onto the screen. So, this array is having 5, array is having size 5 cross 5, because 5 is the number of vertices. So, graph is having A, B, C, D and E. So, 5 vertices. So, we are going to name the columns as well as the rows as A, B, C, D, E, and we will be, you know, filling either 0 or 1 inside the location of arrays. There will be a 0 if there is an vertex from the row to, if there is an edge from the vertex which is written in a row to a particular column. For example, I am taking the row number 2, which is B, and I am taking column number 1, which is A. So, if there is an edge between B and A, that is going to be 1. If there is an edge between B and B, that is going to be 1, otherwise 0. If there is an edge between B and C, similarly 1 and 0. So, here you can see that there is an edge between the two vertices A and B. Now, let us consider edges one by one. So, there is an edge from A to B. So, A is represented, all the edges starting from A are indicated in the row of numbered A, that means the row number 1. So, A to A is 0, because there is no kind of, you can say, self loop, but A to B, yes, there is an edge, so it is 1. Then A to C, yes, again it is an edge. So, A, C location in the array is, you know, filled as 1. Similarly, A, D is 1 and A, E is 0, because there is no, you know, you can say edge onto that particular vertice from A to E. There is no edge from A to E. coming to the vertex B, so all the edges which are, you know, connecting to the vertex B are represented by the second row, we can say. So B to A, if there is an edge, yes, there is an edge from B to A. And my dear viewers, please notice that the graph here is an undirected graph. We haven't used directed graph yet, but yes, we'll be using it shortly. So an edge from A to B will also be regarded as an edge from B to A. So B to A, yes, there is an edge 1. So in the row of B, column of A, we'll fill 1. Then B to B is 0 because there is no self loop. And then B to C, there is no edge, there is no direct edge. So then B to D and then B to E. So in this way we have filled the rows of B. And similarly for C, we are having just two edges, one which is going to A, another one which is going to D. So in the first column and the fourth column, we will fill 1. All other columns of the row C will be filled as 0. Now notice one particular thing, that the diagonal elements here are actually representing nothing but self loop. So here you can say the diagonal elements all are 0 except D comma D, or D, the fourth position I am talking about, fourth row and fourth column. So D comma D is not 0, because notice that in the figure there is an edge from D to D. So this D to D is self loop. So this is a, you know, you can say peculiar property of your adjacency matrix representation, that if you need to look upon just onto the self loops, so you can look at the that whether there are self loops present or not, you can just look at the diagonal elements of the matrix, and then you will be able to know that whether there are self loops present or not present. So here this is the graph, or this is the adjacency matrix of the graph. Now coming to one property which is very particular for this kind of graphs, which are not having direction of edges, basically indirected graphs. So indirected, the matrix, the adjacency matrix which is representing any indirect undirected graph, is going to be a symmetric matrix. That means the elements above the main diagonal are symmetrically, you know, inverted, you can say, or symmetrically filled corresponding to the lower diagonal elements, because this property is because of the fact that there is no direction. So one edge which is between A and B, we can always say that that edge is from A to B, and on the other hand, without loss of generality, we can say this edge is also from B to A. So that similar edge will be counted from A to B, as well as it will be counted from B to A also. So we can say that this matrix is going to be a symmetric matrix if your graph is an undirected graph. Now coming to other scenarios of directed graphs and weighted graphs. So here on the screen you can see that now that particular graph I have taken as a weighted graph. Now weighted graph, and as an directed graph. So directed graph here says there is an edge from A to B. Now here you cannot say that this edge is going from B to A also. It is just an edge from A to B. So A to B, that means the position number 1, 2 is going to be filled by 1, not the position of B, A, which is position number 2, 1. So here this matrix, which is representing a graph of directed type, it is not, it is not a symmetric matrix. This matrix will be symmetric in the case of this undirected graphs only, or there can be, you know, particular condition in which we can say all the edges which are from vertice U to V are, you know, also having an complementary edge from V to U. So in that case also a directed, you know, graph can also have a matrix which is symmetric, but this is a very rare scenario. So if we are talking about a symmetric matrix, we are essentially talking about the you can say it is an undirected graph. So here also you can say, so from A there are two edges which are going towards B and going towards C. So the row which is starting from A is only having two ones at the position of B and at the position of C, others are 0. Coming to the second vertex B, there are edges which are going from B to D as well as from B to E also. So the column D and the column E in the row of the vertex B are, you know, filled as 1, others are filled as 0. Similarly for C, there is only one outgoing edge from C to D. So only that particular column which is that particular cell which is from C to D is filled as 1, and so on and so forth. Here also the self loops are indicated by D comma D scenario. So this is a graph, or this is a graph which is a directed graph, and the corresponding adjacency matrix is also shown here. Now I have taken two examples, one which is of directed graph, another which is of undirected graph. So in that both the cases I have not taken any weighted graph. So here the number 0 as well as the number 1 is just telling you whether that edge is present or whether the edge is not present. 0 is essentially indicates the absence of edge between the vertices, and 1 is indicating the presence of edge. So now what if we are having a graph which is weighted? So for weighted graph, instead of ones and zeros, we can store the weight of the edge. So adjacency of ij will be equals to w, that particular cell of 2D array will be, you know, given that number which is the weight of that particular edge. So if it is a number, then we can say that there is an edge from vertex I to vertex j with weight w. So coming to the examples, example of weighted graph, again that particular graph which I was, you know, taking since two example is a bit modified and taken here as the as a weighted graph, in which there is an edge from A to B. Again, this is an indirected form, so you can always take a directed version of this particular graph also. So again, this is a symmetric matrix, as you can see. So self loop from D to D is 3, there is an edge from A to B is 7, B to E is representing 6, and now on the place of 1s, wherever we have written 1s in the, you know, normal or normal in the sense non-weighted version of this particular matrix, we have represented 0s and 1s to represent edges. We have written 0s and 1 in order to represent the edges. Here we are going to use 0 if there is no edge, and if there is an edge, we will be writing the weight of that particular edge. So I mean, simple. The representation of a weighted graph in the form of an adjacency matrix is also, you can say, very very simple. Now, coming to that, as I have told you that there are, you know, two commonly used kind of representations of a graph through which we can, you know, able to implement or able to represent graph inside the memory of the computer. Both the ways, adjacency matrix as well as adjacency list, are having their own pros and cons. So coming to the pros and cons of adjacency matrix, the implementation implementation here is very easier. We just need to take a 2D array and we are going to fill either 0 and 1 or 0 and some numbers if we are talking about the weighted graph version. One idea is, or the one advantage here is, the implementation of adjacency matrix is very easier because we generally consider array as the most, you can say, trivial data structure to be implemented, whether it is even if it is in the form of a 2D array. And then if we want to insert or delete a particular edge, let us say for example, there is no edge between B and C, and now I want to insert an edge. So, what do we need to do? I am just by taking that particular index from B to C, I will be finding out the location inside the adjacency matrix, and then I will be just changing 1 in place of 0, or in case of deletion, it is going to be an you can say a reverse process, that is replacing 0 in place of 1. So, in this way many queries can be answered in constant time. So, basically these insertion deletions will be constant time operations, because we need to find out that particular index, and finding out index in a array is not difficult, that is just an constant time order 1 operation, and then we need to flip a bit basically. So, it is either 0 to 1 or 1 to 0 in case of insertion and deletion of an edge. So, pretty simple I can say. So, but the problem here is it is going to consume more space. Now, why I am saying it is going to consume more space? This is basically in relation to the adjacency list. So, array here is going to be and 2D array of V cross V size, I can say. So, let us say there is an kind of graph which is a very sparse graph, and the graph is having 100 vertices, but there is only 4-5 number of edges. So, imagine the size of adjacency matrix. With 100 vertices, there is going to be the matrix of 100 cross 100 size, because the storage is any case theta v square storage it is taking. So, a v cross v matrix, 100 cross 100 matrix with having ones only at maybe 4-5 places, or maybe let us say 10 places, 15 places. So, that is you can say it is turning out to be an sparse graph. So, again what we need to do in order to optimize or in order to make it efficient, we need to again convert this into an sparse graph representation, and then we will be changing the representation again. So, basically storage here is a huge problem in case of adjacency matrix, especially when your graph is sparse enough. Another disadvantage we can say, it is like if we need to visit all the neighbors of a vertex, that is a time consuming operation that can be more easily done in adjacency list, or if we need to traverse all the vertices in the graph, that is going to be kind of a time taking operation because of the implementation or because of the storage idea of this adjacency matrix. But yes, on the very other hand, basic operations like in edges and out edges, basic operations like in edges and out edges are expensive when we are using adjacency matrix representation. Only the insertion and the deletion of edges is very inexpensive or very trivial, a constant time operation. Also, if we want to find out that whether there is an edge between a pair of vertices, so means that whether there is an edge between the vertex u and v, what we need to do? Just take out that index u comma v, or that just take out that index u v, and then just check the bit over there. So, even if we are representing the undirected unweighted graphs. So in case of unweighted graph, only there are bits. So every edge is represented in the form of a bit. In this way, we can, you know, optimize the storage also, but again in the form of weighted, for a particular weighted graph, this may not turn up as a, you know, kind of a bit storage, because you cannot obviously store any number within a bit. So there are both pros and cons of this particular strategy of representation of graphs, which is known as adjacency matrix. The biggest disadvantage is it is going to be cost. It is not going to be very cost efficient if we are matrix is sparse enough, that sparse matrix we can say is having this in which the number of edges are very very less as compared to number of square of vertices. So E is less than, very very less than V square, then we can say that the graph is sparse. So for a sparse graph, this is definitely not a space efficient strategy to represent the graph using the adjacency matrix yet. Yes, but whether there is an edge between U and V, then also insertion and deletion of edge, these operations are actually, you can say, constant time operations. But again, if you want to see that what are the vertices or which vertices are present as the neighbor of a vertex, let's say U, that is going to be costly operation. This operation is much much more efficient when we use adjacency lists. So we can say in this particular lecture I have told you the whole thing about adjacency matrix, what actually it is and in what kind of applications or what kind of scenarios we need to use this adjacency matrix. Hope you have enjoyed the lecture. Thank you.